Thanks for the extended and extensive introduction. Good morning to everyone. I consider it as a great occasion to be here on a Teacher's Day in front of students and also teachers. I think I'm in a unique position. I think, you know, I can face both the students and the teachers. So I wish a happy Teacher's Day also. It's very nice to see you all here. I have known Niranjan, not even Mr. because I know him so closely, for a very long time. I have worked with him. I know him very well personally. Since I was asked to talk in the 4D ultrasound workshop, I thought I would first start on sound, what is a sound, and then get into ultrasound. So if you look at sound, it goes back to the 4th century BC. Maybe sound as a physical concept has been there, but at least to our knowledge. Like I think when we started the prayer, we started as Om. In fact, the first cosmic interpretation of sound, Om, the most commonly seen and heard syllable from Hindu mythology that originated in the 2nd century BC. It is also seen in the opening verse of Rig Veda, which is 4,000 years old. I just want to say the first verse. Om Agni Ile Prohitam Yajnasya Deva Ritvijam Hotaram Ratnatatamam. It just praises the fire. What is fire? What is the fire as an energy? So it's just a small verse. The reason I started this was, it starts with Om. So this has been there for the last 4,000 years. So we have heard of this. Now coming to little school physics, what you learned in school. I think Dr. Pillai mentioned about sonar, an acronym for sound navigation and ranging, is used in underwater navigation to communicate or to detect objects under the surface. Echolocation is used by whales, dolphins, to communicate and track prey. The same technique is used by bats on land for the same purpose. Now coming to ultrasound in the form of echo tracking, ultrasonic testing is also used to determine the tensile strength of metals, which I think Dr. Pillai also mentioned. So this, I think we all have come across this in our school days. School physics would have given you an introduction into what sound is, what you can achieve using sound, and you know, what are the advantages of sound. Okay, now I think somebody mentioned something like Brahma, it's nothing like to do with Brahma, but then yes, I'm happy. I was associated with a company which innovated ultrasound for medical imaging. Way back in about 20 years back, I started working with a company by name Aloka. Aloka is a Japanese company, but the name Aloka is an Indian name. It's a Sanskrit name, again, given by a Buddhist monk, which means Aloka means ray of light or hope. Aloka was a pioneer in introducing ultrasound to medical diagnostic usage way back in 1950s. Aloka has an exceptional history as an innovator in ultrasound technology and is known for its high quality systems. Aloka was the first company to introduce ultrasound to the world, ultrasound for medical imaging to the world. They were the first to commercialize 2D medical ultrasound in 1960. Basically for cardiac application, and extended the application to abdomen, obstetrics, gynecology, veterinary, musculoskeletal, etc. In fact, veterinary is something very interesting I would like to share with you. We have sold more than hundreds of such units to veterinarians, and I remember one of my sonologist friend scanning a tiger with the Aloka machine in the Madras Zoo. Tiger was sedated a bit, and he was standing outside the cage to do this. And in fact, we had those pictures. I still have it in my records. That was something very interesting, so I thought I'll just share this with you. So ultrasound is also being used for veterinary scanning. Aloka machines were also used in therapeutic interventional applications, and in 2004, Aloka launched the first 3D ultrasound. I think Aloka was the first company to launch 3D ultrasound. Of course, after that, other major companies have overtaken Aloka in terms of technology and in terms of volume of machines that got sold. But Aloka was the first to launch the 3D ultrasound, and of course followed by real-time 3D and 4D now. Aloka was also involved in the manufacture of general analytical instruments, radiation measurement, and clinical laboratory systems, specimen pre-processing. In 2009, Aloka set up the manufacturing unit in collaboration with an Indian company at Sriperumbudur in Tamil Nadu, Chennai. That was a great achievement for like this Make in India initiative, which I think is being talked about a lot now. A Japanese company setting up a unit in India. And I had the honor of being associated with them to bring them here to set up the unit. Of course, now in business it all happens. There is a up and down. Aloka as a company is no more, it has been taken over by Hitachi. So Aloka is no more part of Hitachi. Okay, that's about Aloka. What is 4D? I think you will be learning more about it today. And I think you will also have an hands-on and see what exactly it is. But I'll just give a short definition or a short resume of what 4D is. Ultrasound technologies have evolved from 2D and now figures 1 to 3D and now 4D, enabling the users to improve the field of view without sacrificing the frame rate. 4D ultrasound simply involves real-time as the fourth dimension. You have X, Y, Z, where you see the three dimension, and once you have three dimension, you know that the frame rate drops. So now the technology has brought in another dimension, the time dimension, to make it real-time faster. 3D ultrasound is generally used during pregnancy to see the fetus. In fact, sometime in 2004, when Aloka launched the first 3D machine, I had it installed to a doctor, Dr. Kamini Rao. She is an expert in infertility. We had installed it and, you know, we were able to get a picture. In fact, that article came in Hindu also, where how the patients are emotionally involved in seeing their fetus moving its hands and, you know, closing its eyes and so on. So that was in 2004. And exactly like the pictures are often captured rapidly to produce a 4D now ultrasound, which involves the addition of movement by stringing together the frames of 3D ultrasound in quick succession. 3D ultrasound is expected to slowly become part of routine care and is expected to benefit pregnant women even more. Aloka launched it basically for the family welfare department, OB-GYN, and associated with neonatal. You know now, more than 4D, I think maybe some of you, if you have Googled it, you would have come across 5D is in the offing. Tissue density is the fifth dimension in 5D ultrasound, which provides clearer picture, more accurate images and finer details. Maybe next year you can have a workshop on 5D ultrasound. The analogy of 2D to 4D, and of course next to 5D, which you will hear a lot, can be the same as that what is seen in the telecom sector. You see the 2G, 3G, 4G, and now I think 5G is also being talked about in the telecom sector. I heard Ambani was, you know, talking about bringing 5G to India, which also it basically refers to the speed with which the real-time data is processed. So in simple terms, like it's just as how fast you are able to visualize the actual motion. So this is about why I'm here, because my background in ultrasound has brought me here. And now the objective of this program, what I perceive and what I want this program to achieve at the end of the day. Recently, the Government of India has initiated various short and long-term skill development training programs to facilitate employment opportunities in industries like healthcare, infrastructure, power, etc. Leading corporate houses have been invited to be a part of this plan which will make India a super skilled country by 2020, coinciding with the superpower mission mark set by our late great teacher, Dr. Abdul Kalam. So that is the initiative. I think this is a small part of that initiative where you people are here, wherein this is a skill development program with regard to ultrasound. So you can have so many such programs. You can have this in medical itself, you can have this in ventilation, you can have this in dialysis, you can have this in various other products. It all depends on your interest and then the availability of the teaching faculty. Mr. Niranjan, MD India Ultrasound, has adopted and has been implementing the skill training program in his domain, that is ultrasound. He has been in ultrasound, I think more than me, I think he has been in for a certain number of years. India Ultrasound Niranjan, in association with National Institute of Electronics and Information Technology, Calicut, an autonomous scientific society of the Department of Electronics and IT, Government of India, has developed a course structured toward developing ultrasound technicians to work in diagnostic centers, you can be hospitals, diagnostic centers or labs, or as service engineers to maintain units, and application specialists who can demonstrate the diagnostic capabilities of ultrasound to prospective doctors. This is something, a very holistic assignment, where you know you are engaged with a doctor. See, whenever we see doctor, we think, you know, doctor, at least in my earlier years, I used to associate doctors with God. You know, because they save you, they give you life, and never they protect you. And so I'm not going deep into it, but then, as an application specialist, if you have a hands-on with ultrasound, you know, you will be in the position, you will be teaching the doctors. So that's it. Again, just to go back, why this program is, you have to understand the industry. What this industry meant, what is this industry can do, what is it is going to be in the next 5-10 years, whether it is really worth pursuing a career in this industry. Yes. In fact, healthcare is being seen as next to software in terms of growth, in terms of opportunities, in terms of employment availability. India spends 2% of its GDP on healthcare, just 2% of GDP, which is much lower than our neighbors, Sri Lanka and Bangladesh. So it starts there. As of now, we are spending only 2% of GDP. I heard yesterday somewhere somebody saying it should go up to 7%, which is going to be a quantum jump. Brazil, China, and Russia have more beds per thousand than India's 0.9 per thousand, which is well below the WHO requirement. India requires 600 to 700,000 additional beds over next 5 to 6 years, throwing open an opportunity of more than $25 to $30 billion. So you can see what this industry is going through. In fact, I think last year we also heard that, like, right to health. If the government passes the right to health bill, this will really accelerate to a level where we need to set up certain minimum requirement as per international standards. So by 2020, the Indian healthcare market is expected to reach 280 billion with a compounded average growth rate of something around 17%, which is a very, very fast growth. Of course, just to go through, just to understand the industry, what is happening in the industry now, in India, the insurance doesn't support the investigation. What happens is, so it's a personal money which is being spent for the treatment. It's going to change. Government will become the major buyer. Once the government becomes the major buyer in terms of insurance or whatever it is, I think that will push the growth in the industry. Medical devices and equipment industry share would be approximately 10% of the 280 billion. Which I indicated by 2020, medical devices will have 10%. And unfortunately, which even Dr. Pillai mentioned when he said, as a country, we are not that great when it comes to developing or manufacturing medical devices. So what is the state of affairs now is 80% of this 10%, whatever the medical device industry, it's an import dependent. It has to be imported. So that is where I think initiative can be brought about, where we have to start manufacturing the devices. So 80% is import dependent. This may be the reason for the government allowing 100% FDI in the medical device sector. The 2011 global ultrasound, now coming to ultrasound, since this is going to be very specific to this particular program, the 2011 global ultrasound medical devices market was $5.6 billion, and that is predicted to grow at a CAGR of 6.2% to reach $8.1 billion. It's a huge market internationally. With India's population, we have a major share in that. So this is how the scenario of the market. So I want you to understand that this market is very large, has got a lot of opportunities to offer, and it's now up to us to get into it and start working towards it. And what should be the takeaway from this program? As per the global medical devices nomenclature, GMDN, the medical equipment industry is highly fragmented with 14,000 different products. You name anything, right from a cotton to a gamma or a PET scan, it all comes under medical devices. So it's a very large range of products, ranging from medical disposables, stents, IVD machines, to nuclear medicine units. You have PET CT, you have gamma camera, and then, you know, coming down, you also have a PET MRI now, and so on. It's a very wide range, highly technology oriented. Being a niche buyers and a sensitive market, see, especially from my experience, I would like to share, I think the Indian market has been very sensitive, orthodox, and it's a buyer's market. The buyer decides what he wants. You can't sell whatever you have. So you have to design a product which is in need. There should be a need for it. And when there is a need for it, it should also take care into what is the investment the person who has a need for it can really bring about. So that's very important to understand. So my point here is, one is, this is a very big industry. Then you have to understand the dynamics, how this industry also works. It's a very sensitive market, and to succeed in the sector, it is essential that the new entrants are, you know, people like you who would be getting into various, some could go for research, some could get into employment, and so on. It is essential that new entrants understand the market dynamics in terms of awareness, the awareness of the industry, awareness of the product, the knowledge. It's very important. As I told you, it's a very huge market with huge range of devices. It will be better like we focus on one particular product and then start to learn about it, develop it, and interact with it. Knowledge on the medical devices, benefits and features. The other great important thing is understanding the patient. The patient is the user. More than the doctor, it's the patient who is going to use this unit. It is going to be applied on the patient. The doctor is only a facilitator. So it's better we understand the patient requirement, what will the patient undergo. And that requires a little presence of mind to set up the device to suit the patient condition. So this is something very important which I would like to share with you from my experience in this industry. For example, I'll share an example with you. Ventilation. What is ventilation? It's just, you know, giving air. Then, to whom it is being given? It is given at a very critical time when the patient is in an ICU or in an operation theater. In an OT, it is called anesthesia ventilator. In an ICU, it is a normal ventilator. So normally, patient is given a ventilator, sometimes at a very fag end of its life. It's a make or break. What is required is, in fact, in this ventilation, even the doctor will not handle the ventilator. If you just go to the hospital, it is more of the paramedics, the nurses, who will be handling the ventilator. It's very important to understand the patient condition here. The patient lung capacity, what is his breathing frequency at that point in time, 100 breaths per minute, 50 breaths per minute. What is the weight of the patient? Because it varies from a child for a neonatal ventilator to an adult ventilator, the requirements are different. So you have to understand the patient condition before actually putting the ventilator or putting the patient into a ventilator. Otherwise, that will be the end of it. I have seen, and more of, on most of the occasions, this becomes a panic situation where under panic, you know, you do things which become a little desperate rather than just to show that you're doing something. And in most of the cases, it has failed. And the responsibility is, of course, the patient is also very critical, so it would be even a natural death. And most of the time, it is also the blame on the device as saying that it did not work. But no, it is more of a panic situation where people are not understood what the patient actually requires, how it has to be set up, what is the volume of air that should go in, and how it has to be monitored. So there, why I think this is an example, it is here, you know, more than a doctor, you should also understand the patient condition before employing a device. And especially, it becomes very critical, maybe not in ultrasound, because ultrasound in India, I don't think even the sonographers are allowed to do ultrasound on a patient. It is not the case in other countries. In US, a sonographer, a technician, an engineer can do. In fact, only he does. There, the doctor never touches the ultrasound. It is the sonographer who does, and doctor only interprets. In India, because of certain requirements, like this PNDT, where, you know, we got into this prenatal sex determination, which ended up screwing up the population demography. Maybe this is a law which has come up, which I think maybe once the awareness increases, maybe I think that may not be required at all. So here in India, maybe ultrasound may not be used by you directly on a patient, but then when it comes to ventilation and, you know, dialysis and things like that, it is very important that you should also understand the patient's side, patient condition before putting them onto the devices. So what is it sum up to? This can happen only through continuous training, technology, and clinical awareness. That has to be there. So it is something called CME, where you have a continuous medical, or maybe the continuous education, where they call CME, you can have it as a continuous medical education, undergo training, have a hands-on read about it. So that's very important. So only this approach will give the ultimate benefit to the patient, which is what this industry is for. That is to save the patient and give this industry a holistic halo. That is what it is. This is a very, very, very holistic industry where you will end up, you will in coordination with the medical practitioner, will actually help in creating a healthy country. So I am in the process of discussing with Mr. Navanjan to launch this kind of programs in other southern states and ultimately to pan India, to benefit the national student community. In fact, today when I met Dr. Pillai in the morning, I heard that National Institute of Electronics is also has offices in Chennai, Srikakulam, and so on. So I think this kind of programs can be extended there in coordination with this institute. So I'm sure Mr. Niranjan will accept my suggestion and come forward with a proposal for a national reach. Again, thanks for the time. I take this opportunity to wish this program a grand success, and I would, especially the students on this Teachers' Day, a grand success in your endeavors also. Look forward to meet you all again in the 5D workshop. Thank you.